All right, church, thank you for tuning in. Today we're going to continue in the book of Mark. We're going to finish out chapter 1, and we're going to hit on another theme that you see in the book of Mark, which is secrecy. Jesus is very public. His authority is very public. Everybody's amazed by him, but he's also very secretive at the same time, and you'll notice this the whole way through the book of Mark, and there's good reasons for it. We're going to start looking at it today, and you'll bump into it all throughout. But let me read this to you. In verse 35, chapter 1, verse 35, rising very early in the morning while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to them, "Let us go to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in the synagogues and casting out demons. So that was through verse 39. We're going to look from verse 40 to 45 in a minute. But you see, there's huge crowds gathering all around. Verse 33 said the whole city gathered together at the door. Like incredible crowds of people everywhere, right? And so early in the morning, while it's still dark, that's obviously earlier than most people get up, right? He departed. Like, I don't know if the crowds were, like, still there or if they had all gone home and were going to get up first thing in the morning and go back. But he got out of there before they got there. He got out of there while it's still dark. He departed, went out in the middle of nowhere, a desolate place, to pray. Simon and those with him searched for him. The disciples, good for them. They went searching for him. But they say they get there and they're like, "Everybody's looking for you." So yeah, whatever these crowds did overnight, they were up in the morning and they're ready for more Jesus. Good for them. Okay, but Jesus is not there. And he doesn't say, "Okay, cool, sorry, tell him I'm sorry I'm late, I'll be right there in a minute." He doesn't say that. He is not, the crowds do not control him. The desires of other people do not control him. He's like, "Let's go to all the other towns. I got to preach there too. I already did some preaching here. I'm glad they like it. That's cool. I'm going to another town now. I'm out of here," okay? And he does. They go, and he went throughout Galilee, all Galilee, preaching in synagogues, casting out demons. That's what he does, all right? So listen, I've said this a few times. Mark is a gospel that's in a hurry. He's moving forward. And so he depicts Jesus doing these things. Jesus really did do these things, of course. All the other gospels, you know, corroborate it and give additional information. But Jesus is in a hurry. There is a time. There is a limited time. There's a certain amount of time that you've got to respond to Jesus. And you don't know how much time that is. And you don't know when he's going to move on to the next town, rise up early and go to the next thing. So let's get in Jesus closely. If you are tracking with Jesus, if you're having a period of time right now in your life where you're growing close to the Lord, then stay on the gas pedal. Do not get complacent. Stay on the gas pedal. And don't be surprised if where you're at now is not where you're supposed to be tomorrow or next year. If you're following Jesus, you might have to go somewhere new. You might have to do something different. You're going to have to stop doing the old things. The old is gone, the new has come, right? You're a new creation. Jesus is not here to please the crowds. He is here to do his calling, his purpose. All right? Now, I'm going to keep reading verse 40. It says, "A leper came to him," someone with leprosy, "imploring him and kneeling and said to him, 'If you will, you can make me clean.' And moved with pity, he stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, 'I will, be clean.' And immediately the leprosy left him and he was made clean. And Jesus sternly charged him and sent him away at once and said to him, 'See that you say nothing to anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer for your cleansing what Moses commanded for a proof to them.' But when he went out, he began to talk freely about it and to spread the news so that Jesus could no longer openly enter a town, but was out in desolate places, and people were coming to him from every quarter." So that's the end of chapter 1. All right, it's a powerful story. A guy with leprosy comes to him, and Jesus touches him and says, "I will that you would be clean. Be clean." And immediately he's healed, okay? Jesus' authority is once again on display. The crowds are there. But I want to look at this secrecy thing. Like we saw in the previous paragraph, Jesus sees the crowds, gets up early, and gets away. There's a little bit of secrecy there. Now, he went off to pray. He wanted some alone time with the Lord to pray, and he can't do that with 100 people jumping around on him. Okay, so that might be the reason, but I think there's a greater reason too. He's not trying to please the crowds. This guy with leprosy gets healed. That's amazing. If it were any church, any pastor, I've been guilty of this myself, we would want everybody to know about it. Whoa, you like what you saw? Make sure you tell everybody to come back next week because we're going to do more of that. You know, that's just how we operate, good or bad. Sometimes it's not bragging. Sometimes it's boasting in the Lord. It's genuine humility, boasting in the Lord. But you can guarantee people are going to talk about it. But Jesus sternly warns him, and you'll see him do this frequently. He did it with casting out demons. Verse 34, he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. Verse 25, be silent, he said. And you're going to see this all through the book of Mark. He tells them to not tell anybody, to keep quiet about it. And it just kind of a head scratcher. Why would you do that? If you're the Son of God, you've come to redeem the world, right? Shouldn't you have, don't you want people to know about this? Why is he so secretive? I think there's a few reasons, and that's what we'll look at, and we'll see more of them as we study Mark and we get to the triumphal entry, which is where Mark is in a hurry to get to. Everything's immediately until that Holy Week starts, and then that's where he's aiming at, and you'll see this theme develop. But just like we saw with John the Baptist earlier in chapter 1, there is an appointed period of time that John the Baptist was called to minister. And then he got arrested, and when Jesus saw that he was arrested, he went around saying, the time is fulfilled, now is my time. These demons will say stuff like this, have you come to torture us? Have you come to get us? Sometimes they say, before the appointed time. Okay, they don't always say that. But Jesus says this. He says it if you read in John, when his mother tells him to turn the water into wine, he's like, you know, step off. He winds up doing it anyway, but he's like, let me set the timetable, not you. Get it? So he tells this guy with leprosy, see that you say nothing to anyone. He sternly warned him, okay? Don't tell anybody. So why not? Why not? There's a few reasons. One reason is because crowds come to him, and sometimes he needs to get away from the crowd. He crosses the lake. He goes up the mountain. He goes to desolate places before the sun even rises. He's trying to get away from the crowd because he wants some peace and quiet with the Lord. He is dependent on the Lord, and he knows that. He's dependent on the Lord. He's not there to please the crowds. If you're there to please the crowd, you become dependent on the crowd, and you're going to do things and say things that please the crowd. You become dependent on them. He doesn't want that, so he wants to get away. That's one reason. Another reason, he has places to go. He has to preach in other places, okay? So he's going to move on from one place, all right? There's another reason. He's not here to build a movement. He's not here for, they want to follow him, and crowds do this. They if they find somebody they like, they will continuously lift that person up and raise them up, and put them into some position of authority or power. And of course, most of these guys, many of them, were looking for some kind of savior from Rome, and they were going to try to propel him into that position or something. And so he wants them to know, whether they accept it or not, that, look, I'm not here for that. And if he did the opposite, go tell everybody. Make sure you tell everybody about this. Make sure you tell them. If he encouraged it, then there would just be more of it and become sensationalized and everything else, and he's not there. He's not here for that. Okay, but I think even beyond that, there's a greater reason, and you'll see it when we get to the triumphal entry to the Palm Sunday opening of Holy Week in the book of Mark, that he is actually fulfilling prophecy from Daniel. Remember, Daniel had those dreams about the 70 weeks and the 60 weeks and the half weeks and the this and that. And you do the math on it. Jesus is actually fulfilling prophecy. There is a timeline. There is a heavenly timeline that all of world history follows, whether we are aware of it or not, whether we understand it or recognize it or not. And just as John the Baptist was there to introduce Jesus for a certain period of time, Jesus has a particular period of time, a calling to the ministry, to go town to town, place to place, person to person, disciple to disciple, and accomplish these certain tasks. And he's in a hurry to do it. He has a very limited amount of time to do it, and there is a date when he has to ride into Jerusalem, and he has to be there that day. He's going to fulfill prophecy to do it. And I believe he did it on purpose. I believe he intentionally fulfilled prophecy. A lot of his prophecies, you know, just were fulfilled by Christ, like inadvertently or whatever. He didn't directly control them. But when we get there, we'll see it. I'm giving you a preview now. But he's literally fulfilling prophecy intentionally. And he has to be there on that particular date, or else he doesn't fulfill it. You know, so it doesn't happen. And so everything else in between, he has to do the other things right and line them up. And until that day, that's the day when all the people are bowing down and dropping their palm branches and saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. This is a particular prophecy that they would do that on that day and say those things on that day. And that's the day, and he's supposed to be riding in on a colt, the foal of a donkey, right? He's supposed to be doing that. That's a fulfillment of things. Until then, he has to fulfill all the other things. He has to do all of them. So he's not here to reveal his messianic nature, his anointed one of God, that he is the Christ. He's not here to reveal that yet. He's here to do the teaching, to do the healing, to announce that the kingdom of God is at hand, the time is fulfilled, and so on. But it's only then that it becomes public and he intentionally rides in as the King of Kings. And so in the meantime, he's trying to keep it secret. Nobody's listening to him. They're all spreading the word anyway. And you would too, and I would too. I would tell people if I had leprosy and all of a sudden I got better, I would. People would ask, and I would definitely tell them, right? So that's what he's getting at there. And what it does, what it creates for you and I, what it means for us and what it meant for the people at the time is, will you follow Jesus even when things are slightly unclear? Even when you don't know for sure exactly what you're doing and what you're getting into. And he won't come out and say it. Don't you always just want Jesus to answer your prayers with, like, audibly? Like, okay, now I know the answer. Now it's all clear. Jesus just said it. Don't you want that? But yet you don't usually get that. You usually have to kind of get certain guideposts that keep you in the general direction. And you kind of have to feel your way through it. And we call it living by faith and not by sight. Are you ready to do that? Are you ready to live by faith, even if Jesus doesn't give you the clear, distinct answer that you absolutely think you need, and you want it to be just completely clear, and he's like, I'm not going to tell you the details. It's not time for that yet. Will you follow him when you can't see? That there's a time where you will see, where your faith will be sight, okay, where you will see clearly face to face. There will be a time when that happens. But are you willing to follow him even in the dark? Are you willing to follow him even when it is foggy? Are you willing to follow him even when the world around us is just a morass of sin and darkness and craziness and confusion? Will you follow Christ even then? When he gets up early in the morning and he goes to the new town and it's hard and you don't know where he went and you're searching for him, will you search for him? Will you do it? Will you follow him? Even though it's secretive, even though you're not sure what you're getting into, will you follow him anyway? Lord God, I pray that everyone here, we would all follow you anyway. Follow you when we don't know how. In Jesus' name. Praise the Lord, church. We're going to pick up chapter 2 tomorrow. God bless. See you then.